Hello, malty, marvellous, merry malt monsters. Welcome to the Bothy. Welcome to Ralfy Review 839 Extras, where I talk about wider subjects beyond specific spirit reviews, because it's all part of the conversation, and the conversations that we have with one another through social media, forums, platforms, in shops, in bars, at whiskey clubs, they inform us far more effectively and quickly than was the case in the past. It's really not that long ago that Scotch whiskey was essentially all about the blends. And to some extent it still is, although blends are facing more and more competition globally from other more flavoursome liquors. Some are quite good, but quite a number of blends I feel have lost their way, specifically through their cask policy. The quality of the wood is not what it used to be, and anybody who buys a bottle of old blend from an auction house very quickly gets the references and the bearings when they taste them side by side, the old and the new. None more so than Johnny Walker Red Label, which, I mean, I have a little bottle in the house which I just take a little sip from. It's from the 1960s and it's absolute nectar. The calibre of the sherry cask is simply second to none. And it's right there in the liquor. And you compare it to a Johnny Walker Red Label nowadays, the two are completely unrecognisable. The new one is simply young, slightly chemically jobbing long drink whiskey stuff that you'll find in bars. I mean, that's what it is, folks. And inevitably, I know, I'm perceived as being slightly snobby about it, but that's because, unlike many people, I'm constantly nosing and tasting single malt whiskies. So my palate has changed over the years, and I'm sure that if I was a young person hanging out in a bar somewhere in South America wanting to look cool, having a bottle of Johnny Walker in the bar would probably look pretty cool, and I'd be very happy with the experience, so long as I added enough ice or Coca-Cola to the whiskey, you know. But in the old days, I'm talking even when I started with whiskey in the 1980s, the options were relatively limited, and you'd see unusual bottles of single malt, and generally people ignored them in Scotland, saying, well, that's just for the tourists. The tourists will buy that, particularly the Germans. The Germans will come over on holiday and they will know exactly what malts from where, and they'll know all about the still sizes, and they love that sort of thing, and they buy these bottles of whiskey and they fill their suitcases up with them and go home again. And when I was a student, actually, I was a student in Aberdeen, northeast Scotland, and I did some sailing, so I was a member of the sailing club. Now, the college that I was at didn't have a sailing club, so they shared with the university, which did have a sailing club. But these university people looked down their noses at the college people because they were a lesser species, which is a very, very traditional British attitude. So we tended to get relegated, the college boys and girls get relegated to the smaller boats, which really suited us because, to be honest, they were more fun and you could have a laugh. So my boat partner was Gunther. Gunther was from Cologne, and he was a really positive guy, very positive person, lovely, lovely company. We got on really, really, really well. And of course, we're out in the boat sailing, and we're tacking, you know, the sail and all the rest of it. I won't go into sailing speak, but we're having a lot of fun because it's a good breeze, as you usually get in Scotland. I said, what are you doing this weekend, Gunther? And he says, I'm going to this distillery, and then I'm going to that distillery, and I'll get a taxi from that distillery to that distillery. And I'm thinking, who does this? You know? And there was almost a sense of pride in Scotland that, you just go for a standard blend, you'd knock it back in a one or no water, and you go, you'd wince up your face, and that was you enjoying your whiskey. And importantly, if you're a party, you'd remove the lid from the whiskey and you never put it back on again, because it was a gesture of your hospitality that people around you could get drunk at your expense. So these were the good old days, and my goodness, how things have changed. How things have changed. The number of people in Britain who are discovering whiskey, and I'm not just talking about Scotch whiskey, but there's some wonderful English and Welsh whiskies out there. And we've not even reached Ireland yet. Throughout the British Isles, it's a perfect location for malted barley matured spirit. And I'm always on the lookout for English whiskey, because I'm very happy to buy it and very happy to review it. And I am totally spoiled for choice, because it's not just Britain, the global availability of all spirits, which is primarily due to the internet, has just exploded the opportunity to taste really obscure stuff from really obscure places. So a huge amount of change has happened with the customers, but not so much in the whisky industry. It's still a very traditional place. Now, there's some good reasons for that. You know, that they stick by the rules. There's a lot of self-governance going on. There's a lot of positive interaction between distilleries and competitive support. So you have a situation where if a distillery is needing a piece of equipment or have a breakdown or a failure, they'll phone some other distilleries around them and the other distilleries will help them out. And there's a simple reason for that, because the favour may need to be returned someday. It's practicality. It's creating a good rapport. And I know that in some areas of the world, the distilleries are bitter, bitter rivals. They would never dream of helping each other out. In fact, to go further, I know of at least one rum distillery in the Caribbean which has been nobbled by a competitor. But that's another story for another day. It's real life. Beautiful whiskey, this. I'll tell you about it shortly. Big event in a glass. So the Scotch whisky industry has prided itself in being conservative, that it must bottle at a minimum of 40%, that the spirit must be matured minimum of 3 years, and it must be in oak casks not exceeding 700 litres. And that's a good thing, because it helps provide continuity. But the problem is that continuity can go both ways, particularly when it comes to casks. Because if you're using inferior cheap wood, or using your casks too often, past their point of exhaustion, you start to get inferior versions of your product. And if you happen to just cross your fingers and hope that people will keep buying it, well, good luck to you if you're a distillery. That trick will work only so long, but once our distillery really starts to lose its reputation, it will struggle to pull it back, because there's always a competitor out there to take its place immediately. So with blends, for example, there's a point. Here's a good, really good example. Teacher's Highland Cream, very reputable blend, very popular in Scotland, because 45% of that blend was single malt whiskey, and specifically it was Ardmore. And Ardmore as a single malt is a great blending whiskey. It dovetails and synergizes beautifully with a mash bill grain column still whiskey, which is incorporated into blended Scotch. And then a few years ago, they abruptly removed the declaration in the back of the label that the whisky was 45% single malt. And the Highland Cream, Teacher's Highland Cream, you know, is still available out there. But in my opinion, it's a shadow of its former glory. Now, they could rectify things by upping the strength to 43%, but no, no. the Scotch whisky industry is very traditional, which makes it exciting when a relatively small single malt distillery starts to do something which nobody else seems to be picking up on or doing. But in this particular moment in time, when people are spoiled for choice, when people are communicating and being informed to a degree that was never possible, just not possible 10 years ago, that something small but well-intentioned and lightly stated is going to get noticed, and it will be identified for what it is, genuine innovation. So here you have Isle of Arran, 10-year-old single malt, and it's got Braille in the front label, which means it's being very inclusive and respectful of people who have difficulty in seeing, who are visually challenged. And I think it's may seem quite a small thing, but I think it's very important because it is genuine innovation in an industry which is very reluctant to innovate and which tends to repackage the same thing time after time after time and really wing it on a reputation and a level of enthusiasm from many, many people around the world, which sometimes, just sometimes, I think the Scotch whisky industry takes advantage of. I'm known for, I'll give an opinion, but I am being circumspect here. It's still the case that maybe about 5% of whisky customers are people like you and me that take more than a passing interest. The majority are the occasional buyers from supermarkets, from online, who are buying for birthdays and New Year's and Burns Nights and all the rest of it. And they're still very reliant, particularly for blended Scotch whisky, on selling in through bars and hotels. And you'll see the same brands every time up on the racks. It's always the case. And for the majority of people, that's what they want. But see, this minority, it's a very international minority. It's a very cohesive minority, and it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and it will continue to get bigger. And then suddenly, when there's a huge period of inflation and economic turbulence, which is just round the corner, these small minority, well-informed customers are going to suddenly become much more important. So a really good time to see some additional proper integrity innovation. And I'm not talking about a new label on the bottle and the marketing blurb, which is written by marketing people for marketing people, and I don't think they realize how patronizing it comes across as when it's delivered through social media. A fabulous release, we're innovating with this, and you're looking for them, there's nothing there, it's just a different color of label. It's quite patronising. There's much, you know, I think there really has to be a reconfiguration and a recalibration of marketing sensibility and sensitivity right across the industry. Now would be a good time to invest in that. Now I'm going to bring your attention to this. Here is another innovation. Now, this has happened purely by default. This is a local supermarket where I am. Very accessible, popular supermarket because it has ethical policies. And never before than now, ethics really, really matters. People feel reassured with ethics because lack of ethics means more and more toxicity, poison and bad stuff goes into the food supply, which then leads to cancer and other ill health. So you've got a supermarket which, sure, they have the big brands and all the rest of it you'd expect to see, but they have their own brands, which are generally of pretty good quality, and they are sensibly and ethically sourced, and also they tend to be supporting local communities as well. Now, I worked for the co-op many years ago, so I've got an extra insight into this, and I know that things may have changed since I left my employer, but they've not changed that much. But here you have supermarket standard blended whiskey. And the first thing I want to bring to your attention is right there. That says 3 years old. This is just their jobbing off the shelf blended whiskey for mixing. It says three. I'll read it exactly what it says. Oak aged 3 years. Oak aged 3 years. Not only that, on the back of this cooperative label, you have Braille. And it's not just a simple statement as you have in the Arran saying Arran single malt, which is great. This is simply more communicative and more informative. And anybody literally picking up that bottle from any angle is going to feel that raise. And anyone who reads Braille will recognize it immediately. But it doesn't stop there. This is a humble, cheap little bottle of Scotch whiskey. The glass is lighter than your standard bottle for environmental reasons. They use stronger, lighter glass. There is less weight in the empty bottle. There is less waste when it gets recycled. So, more innovation. But it doesn't stop there. And I'm going to invite distillers around the world to go to your supermarket. If you're in Britain, go to the co-op and buy a bottle of this. Because you're going to learn a lot from the experience. And on the back of the label, there's something else that you never, and I mean never, see in any single malts from official bottlers. Do you know what you get here? An ingredients list. By law, all foodstuffs in the British Isles and the UK, by law, must state the ingredients. When it comes to alcoholic beverages, zoop, zoop, nothing said, nothing, no information at all. And yet the industry will, they'll put their hand in their heart with full of angelic righteousness. Oh, we use three simple ingredients in our whiskey. We use pure spring water cascading through the glen, down through the heather, it's filtering through the heather, you know, folks, it's filtering through the heather. Oh, give us a break. And we've the best malted barley, premium malted barley. And then there's the yeast, our own distillery yeast. The same that 90% distillers use. Why do all the distillers use virtually the same yeast? Not all of them. Simple. Because they're too lazy to explore other versions and permutations of yeast in small batches to innovate. If you want to know about whiskey, spend some time with brewers and beer makers. They will teach you so much, which will become very meaningful for when you're addressing whiskey. Because what is whiskey? It's essentially, it's distilled beer. Not quite, but essentially. So I'm going to read out the ingredient list here for you malt mates on this humble, cheap, ubiquitous bottle of blended Scotch. Nothing, no fancy shapes on the label. I mean, it's actually labelled to make it look basic deliberately, to show you, looking at that label, this is probably the cheapest bottle you can buy in the shop. And here they're saying in the back of the label, blended Scotch whiskey, a blend of Scotch whiskies matured in oak casks for a fuller flavour. Ingredients, water, Scotch whiskey, in brackets, grain spirit, malt whiskey, close brackets, colour, plain caramel, in brackets, and cleared using filtration. Cleared using filtration. I'm going to ask you a question here. Can you think of any brand of Scotch whiskey ever that states in their label that they clear it with filtration? No, me neither. I have a huge amount of respect for this. This, in fact, I think previously I've reviewed another version of this because it's just so damn decent. It's just, do you know, it's honest. I really appreciate something that's honest. This is one of the problems I have with rum. I try to be tolerant because I know less about rum than I do about whiskey, but the more I do my research and the more I listen to the feedback that I get from rum rascals who are keeping me informed, because they're learning a bit about whiskey and I'm learning from them about rum, and the amount of dosing, that's what they call it, dosing, of sugaring of rum, and every single time it happens it dumbs down the flavour. And there's certain independent bottlers who have a reputation for it, so it's not just official bottlings. One of the things I discovered at London Rum Festival a few years ago was actually a lot of rums, they lose their identity because of the ubiquitous sugar-coated caramelised presentation at 40%. A luxury deluxe rum fancy decanter, but 40%? I don't think so. But I'm getting distracted here. I've just poured myself a glass of 3-year-old. I know it's 3-year-old. It's 40% standard jobbing blended Scotch whiskey. And I can tell you, on the nose alone, I would choose this over quite a number of established proprietary brands. Which, by the way, you go looking for an age statement now in blended whiskey, traditional blended whiskey, you'd be struggling to find them. Sure, Chivas do it, Johnny Walker do it, but they're just basically keeping their presence, their profile and their reputation. It's the reason the age statements are there. Except for the blue label, of course, but I never buy that. Taste. Fresh, juicy, custardy, brulee, turning citrus and sour. A little bit of bitterness coming in, but still that resinous, simple sweetness. Not a lot of finish to it, but hey, it's 3 years old. It's 3 years old, and it's something like £12 a bottle. And you can't go wrong. Every single serious whiskey collector needs to have a bottle of proprietary blended supermarket whiskey in the house. And I'll tell you why. I'm going to conclude in this, I'll tell you why. So as that they can realise more articulately just how bad some single malt whiskies become. Because you can do a direct taste comparison. And when you're actually getting a more positive experience from the smell and taste of a supermarket 3-year-old grain Scotch whiskey, blended whiskey, compared to some, and I do mean some, of the single malts that are going on out there, it's an education. It really, really is an education. It's one of the purposes I'm here for, to share the journey. Anyway, should I? Just did it. See, doing this, having tasted that and tasted that, very different whiskies, and now I've got to mix them both together. Have I ruined this? No. Because that's good quality. This blend, 3-year-old blend, good quality. And basically I've enhanced this 3-year-old blend with some fine single malt. Still relatively young. But I'm getting a third whiskey. And see, when you nose and taste it, having tasted them separately, now you're tasting them together and nosing them together. It is such a satisfying experience of learning and seeing how they adjust and bring themselves together, how they can tussle for control, how they can blend together amicably. All these things can happen. And there's only one way for you to find out how it works, and that's to do it. Just saying. That's all. The character of the Aran dominates, but now the honey notes have been enriched by the brulee notes of the blended Scotch. It's not diminished this malt in any way whatsoever. If anything, it's just simply enhanced the range of complex, the range of flavour components within that dram. Whew, I'm done. Thanks for watching, folks. Pop back again. My next ralfy review will be 840, and I'll be reviewing something which resembles the Death Star from The Empire Strikes Back. I know some of you have probably sussed out already what it'll be. Thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this. Subscribey, clicky, likey, etc, etc. And a big thanks to all my Patreon pals for patroning me. I know it's been a kind of tough time with the platform, but I really do appreciate it, and that's why I give you extra content if you're a Patreon pal. And also, for folk who are continuing to buy my bookie, I'll bring it out. I'm holding the top together with a clothes peg because it's a paperback and it would get all splayed out if I didn't. Here's my book, Search for a Whisky Bothy by Ralfy. And if you go and check it out, you'll see it's got a 5-star review on Amazon. But probably best buy it from the printers, who are lulu.com, L-U-L-U.com. Malt mates, it's, as always, it's been a pleasure and a joy and a great waste of time, a very satisfying and informative waste of time for all of us, for you and for me, because we could be wasting our time doing something else. I'm Ralfy. Bye-bye.